Let me, if I can, talk to you about the research project. So the research project, very similar to you, we have about somewhere around, I think, 15 to 20 students. And again, this is the issue. We have you, then we have students that show up physically and take the class at the University of Tennessee on Monday and Wednesday. And then we have distance education people that are from different parts of the country are taking these classes. So we have three really different target audiences. The question on reliability, and we had a meeting with about 10 people yesterday, and I'm going to share with you what I shared with them. This research project could have different types of flavors. The most practical part is you say, we're going to go to an organization and I'm going to do an assessment of their understanding of reliability and what metrics they use, so it's a detailed case study of an organization. And this is what they use, and this is the opportunities for them to improve. That would be a case study and a paper. You could, for example, so those would be very practical, hands-on kind of work. The other part is for example, do you remember the Toyota production system? You know, we have this little thing that goes from here and has arrows and all that kind of stuff, right? You remember that? When you look at the literature, we say that reliability, if you notice, is dependent upon what? It is dependent upon the resources required for the reliability of this class. The students have to be here, I have to be here, the information has to be here, the books have to be here, whatever it is that is required, resources required, to make this a successful class. Generally speaking, the minimum set is, if you remember, is we talked about is people, equipment, material, and schedules or information. These are the four pieces of minimum that have to come together, let's say in manufacturing, what has to come together? The people, the equipment, the material, and the schedules have to come together for you to be able to produce something. In a hospital, what has to come together? The people, the material, the equipment, and schedules have to come together for you to have this. Now, when I start the Toyota production system, and on the bottom it says things like, improvement by small groups of people, which is like 5S, mistake proofing, visual control, things like this. When I 5S, that means I'm going to go and clean an area up. What are the critical drivers of that reliability? It's definitely not this. It's definitely not this. It's not definitely. It's the people to be able to go clean it up. Fair enough? I go up the line so long and say, oh my God, in this category right here, the key driver is people. Up here, oh my God, what are we talking about? A cell design, let's say. Layout. What's the key in a cell design? Equipment. The layout of equipment. The availability of material. And people. That seems to be the key drivers. So every little component of this, as I am improving, because what you're going to do is improve systems. And you need to kind of understand what are the key drivers of that. That study has never been done before. We have started it, and I've got a small paper written that's a draft paper. You can read that. I've been giving it to everybody. What if I could take a section of this and say, hey, let me show you not only can I tell you which is important, but how can I quantify it? That's a paper. You take this to Y12 or to ORNL or to Rubbermaid and say, based on my case study, here is what I understand and how this works. That's a paper. You say, nobody has defined people reliability. You say, my perception on based on reading, watch this. I'm now going from practical to spending time on the internet or in the library, right? What is human reliability? I start defining it, and I said, this is my perception of what human reliability is and how I measure it. That's a paper. Equipment reliability, there's a lot of stuff. Material reliability, oh my God, I can figure this out. Safety, schedule reliability, that's what you were doing. That could be papers. You could say, I don't care about all this. I want to go find out in East Tennessee of the companies around Knoxville, I'm going to send them a survey and they're going to respond and say, this is what they think of reliability. I'm going to collect that information and put it together. That's a paper. These papers are up to you for you to define what you want, how to put it together. The key in a paper is what? Two components. One, we use that to enhance your knowledge. So because you're going to go into the library and you're going to go do all this stuff, you're going to read on this, and it's going to enhance your reliability. But what you read, just like we saw, that requirements planning according to your book, to me doesn't make sense because it doesn't talk about the subtle parts of requirements. Similarly, I want you to be able to develop your template in your mind, whatever you do. If this is what you want to work on, what do you think from here on out when you write that paper? The paper in itself is not important. The fact that you now know what it is, how to measure it, what to do with it, and you can take it back to work, and I promise you will, is very important to me. So the paper has two components. What have you learned from what already exists? Then take that and tell me what you think. Okay? Why? Because the most important asset in this room is your ability to think. Why do you think we're so focused on paradigm shifting and making sure that you think differently? Because I think that is the most important asset in this room. Because if you think differently, the rest of your life, no matter where it is, you're going to take portions of that and start applying it. And if I can get you to even take 20% out of these classes and change the way you think, I am not so concerned about how you are going to do your projects, but the people when you are going to mentor and as you grow and get into different positions, how are you going to talk to them? What language are you going to use? The people, like many of you have told me that at Y12 or ORNL, nobody listens to us because they don't have that language. If you're the next generation at Y12 or ORNL, but you have that language, but the people coming behind you not have an easier time than you, that's really the key. That's the key. That is really the essence of why we're going to do this research paper. Is that okay? Now, we were talking earlier. If you're having problems, come and see me. I mean, one, I'm not that easy to get hold of. It simply is not because I don't like you, right? It is because I can tell you, when I go to my office, I get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, and I go home around 5:30. I don't have maybe 5 minutes to myself to think. I mean, I don't eat lunch. I mean, I'll grab something on the way out. But I don't eat lunch, I don't eat breakfast. Not because I don't want to have lunch, it's simply that at every moment somebody wants part of your time. But if you say you're coming to my office and set up an appointment as an individual or as a team, I'm happy to listen to you. And I can promise you, your research paper is going to be easier on you, it is going to be better. Your capstones are going to be easier and it's going to be better. Right, so those are the things that I would recommend that you do. And if you can't get a hold of me, Carla. Right. Don't tell her I said that. Right? So then, so those are your papers. So what I want you to understand is you have very practical approaches to this paper. You can have a theoretical approach to this paper. It is based on your need. What do you want? Right? You say, for example, we don't have any reliability in my function, my department. You come and say, let me show you what it is, and then say, here is my proposal and my research on how I would implement reliability into my organization. Boom. Very practical, very useful to you, but that could be your research paper. Are we okay? Are you sure? Yes, sir.
The research paper that we're going to do, we're going to turn in our draft for a midterm and get and then
that's what I'm going to do. See, I'm going to take it. What I'm thinking about is because I have graders, and I think for you guys it's good because like your papers were graded by Enrique, and he and I were. I told you the story. We were in Mexico. I said, Enrique, did I grade well? He said, yeah, you really graded well. I said, is it the grades I would give? He said, no, they're a little higher than what you would give. So that's good.
Are you going to let him grade again?
The draft I'm going to look at.
Okay.
Because it's very important for me to understand what you're thinking. The final paper I may have Enrique grade. But the draft is so that you can come and say, so I can say, I've read it, let me give you some response back.
Yeah, the posting was a little confusing. It's probably just me.
It's not.
So the draft is
I tell my graduate students what to do. Sometimes when I see what they posted, it is not exactly what I said, right? So sometimes I have to call them back and say, I don't understand what you wrote, but I told you what you wrote.
But the midterm grade is that initial submission of the report, and the final grade is the
final
exam.
I'm going to give you something that I'm going to give you something in class where you're going to write and you're going to show me that you can do some of this stuff. So it's not about just a, here's a paper. I don't know whether you know reliability or not. If I gave you R1 is 0.6 and R2 is 0.3, and you calculate the reliability of the system.
There's some
all right. See, this class, I think, is not very good. The reason is, by the time...
Yeah, I was like, which
no,
one?
No, 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 no. It is, the resource is the scheduling because... One, by the time we take a break from that and come back, then immediately there's lunch break. We don't get as much done as we do in the first class. So, I think. So here's, I'm going to quickly review what we had earlier, but I'm going to take you into the details of the kind of things that I'm going to put on the exam. Can you see it? No.
I've got a question before we jump into this. So you mentioned that this is also being taught on campus, and then there's a distance.
Yeah.
Would it be possible to get access to the videos that you all provide to the distance education folks?
That would be really helpful, but I didn't want to shortchange you. I mean, I want to still have connection with you.
No, I agree. I'm just saying for in terms
absolutely.
Of just because of the time crunch in this
because
class.
Because we do a lot better job of covering the material in that class than we do here. It is simply 2 hours and 15 minutes that I get. We start the class, we don't stop until the hour and 15 minutes, and it's just logical in the progression. So those classes are available to you, and we do a better job of covering the material than we're doing here.
I was just saying, just for the time crunch, if it would be good to see, because I'm assuming that they probably have lectured the whole time.
The only thing I have to figure out is what is the logistics associated with getting you the material. I mean, from my perspective, I would love for you to have those.
Okay.
All I have to do is go ask how we do that.
Okay.
And if you do take those, I would kind of understand and come and talk to me. I would look at those lectures because those lectures, in my opinion, are a lot better because I start, there's no stopping, there's nothing going on, and we just focus on that lecture.
Okay.
All right, so on... the reliability, we talk about reliability of different systems. You can't see a thing, but supposedly, this is TSA. This is where you get checked. This is the luggage system, and this is the airplanes and the flights. Which of those do you think has the highest? Thank you. It's good. Which of these do you think has the highest reliability? Right. Possibly this. The reliability of the airplane is fairly high. Of the millions and millions of flights that we have per day, it is every so often, once every 2 years or 3 years, that you hear that there has been an accident and people have been killed. This we know is the worst, because you lose your luggage or you miss your luggage every so often. The question for me was not about this is good or this is bad. This is national security, isn't it? Or security, not national security, security of airplanes. How reliable do you think that process is?
Depends how you rate it.
To get people through, or actually detect something or not detect something?
I'm assuming that we're looking for, the reason we have that is to detect things that are not supposed to go onto airplanes.
I would think that would be a hard thing to measure, because you know when luggage is lost, you know when a plane crashes. People don't self-report, yeah, I got that knife that I wasn't supposed to carry through, or...
Right. But they run tests on themselves too and publish that data.
Right. Yeah.
And you can extrapolate.
Right.
You know, based on that number of tests.
Right.
I guess.
So, isn't it important that we know what the reliability of that system is? Now, so the definition of reliability has many, many different things. The ability of an apparatus, machine, or system to consistently perform its intended or required function or mission on demand and without degradation or failure. That is the definition of reliability. And what are the key issues? Okay? Key issues. The ability of a system to consistently perform its intended function. Intended function. The first question that you have to ask is, the systems or the departments that you're working on, when they were formed, is the work that was done at that time 20 years ago or 40 years ago the same work that you're currently doing now? The answer is no. So if the intended function has changed, but the people and the processes are the same, does that change the reliability of that system? Two. Required function or mission on demand. On demand. Right. And third, without degradation or failure. So that is the definition that we're going to use. Now, there are two different types of systems that I want you to become familiar with. Okay. One is physical systems. You see that? This is a physical system, and therefore I should be able to calculate the reliability of this physical system. What is more important than a physical system? What about strategy? You see, this is the Toyota production system, the thing that I was trying to bring up there. This is the Toyota. What is it? Is this not a strategy by which I'm going to reduce the cost of an organization? Is that not what this is? So I must do this, and then I must do this, and therefore I must do this, and then this. This is a strategy, isn't it? Now, isn't it important where I told you about your paper and said, if the reliability of this is 0.5, and this reliability of this is 0.9, 0.6 and 0.3 and 0.2 and 0.8 and 0.9, etc. down the line. And if I could put all the reliabilities in, could you tell me the reliability of successfully putting an initiative into Y12 or RNL? You could calculate that? Could you not? These are the two capabilities that I want you to have. Reliability of a physical system
I'm passing a document, what is that reliability? But more importantly, nobody thinks about it, the reliability of what? A strategy. So if you're going to propose a strategy at home or at work, should you not be able to look at it? Now, what we can do is the following, and this is the lecture where I said I kind of introduce you to flow and the impact of reliability on flow, impact of reliability on disruptions, impact of reliability on variations. And the next set of steps is this is what we're going to do. I'm going to introduce you to known systems. Known systems are what? The easiest is I have a structure. Watch this, a structure. The structure is known. And I know the reliabilities. I don't know where the numbers came from, but if I know the reliabilities and I know the structure, it's very easy for me to calculate the reliability of the system. The problem is that I sometimes don't know where I calculate the reliability, so I'm going to show you here in the next set of slides that what the reliability of the system is going to be, how do I calculate it. I'm going to show you that if the structure is not known, if the structure is not known, how to develop an equivalent structure so that here I know both, here I don't know both, so I can change that. And then I'm going to show you for every system how you calculate the reliability of the system and you create boundaries.
We know
different type of boundaries that says, oh my God, look at the reliability boundary. If I pass this boundary, oh my God, I must be in trouble. So we're going to have boundaries. And then we're going to connect all of this reliability stuff to designing systems. Are we okay with this? What have we done so far? Not well, I think, but only shown you the importance of reliability to flow, variation, and disruption. So here is what I want to present to you, is my thought process of how I look. For example, when I say a surgery, I must look at what is required to do a surgery. What are all the things? And therefore, I must calculate the reliability of all of those things. In this classroom, what must I calculate? The reliability of student coming in, the reliability of professor coming in, the reliability of the information being delivered to Jeremy. Okay, those are seem to be the three things. And food. Reliability of food. So, those. What is reliability? Reliability is to perform a task on demand. What we must go back and look at is what are the resources that must come together and what are their reliabilities. And some I say, reliability of this is this, and these are the four things that we want to do. Now,
okay, so when you do the exchange,
let's focus that we understand on equipment, but we can equally talk about people or materials. We say that an equipment is binary, either 0 or 1. 0 is if the device fails, and 1 is if the device functions properly. Fair enough? Is that okay? Now, the structure of how we structure an organization, structure an equipment, structure a production system, impact whether it works or not. What do you think? The structure? Yes or no?
This is the Gaussian elimination that you would do to fix that.
Let Xi represent components Xi so that the set of n components that comprise a device is represented by a component status vector. What is a status vector? Status vector. Status vector. X is if my system is working, yes. X1 is what? People. X2 is equipment. X3 is materials. X4 is, I'm going to talk about system. Now I'm going to talk about equipment. The equipment is going to, my car is going to run if the engine runs. If it has tires. You see what I'm looking at. The components describe the status vector. So how many components do we have that are we defined here? 1, 2, 3, 4, right? How many components in a car? I don't know. Depends on how you break up the car. So
this.
If it's people, it could be 0 and 1, right? If it's equipment, it could be 0 and 1. If it's materials, it could be 0 and 1. If it's schedules, it's 0 and 1. So I have possibility of 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, and everything in between. All possibilities. Question is, between the 0, 0, 0, 0, which is nothing is working, and we know therefore nothing is going to work, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, everything is working, therefore the system is going to work. These are independent of what? Structure. What about 1, 0, 0, 1? 0, 0, 0, 1. Everything in between those two extremes is dependent upon the structure that you use to design your system. Are we okay with this?
Say it one more time.
I don't think I can. All right. For my production to work, or an else production, I must have the people. I either have them or not. 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. So now I have 1, 1, 1, 1. I know that works. I also know that 0, 0, 0, 0 does not work. What about everything in between? Does, for example, 1, 0, 0, 1, does that work? Yes or no?
No.
You don't know. That is dependent upon the kind of structure that you design. What structure?
If it's parallel, I guess you're
the structure that
parallel.
You're thinking about systems
series.
Thinking.
Yeah. Okay.
Systems thinking and lean.
Right?
Now, here's a 3-component system. Is that okay? Just like here we have 4-component system, right? Here we have 3-component system. One of these are not referred to as status vectors. Right? These are status vectors. Are we okay? Let's take this status vector. And what I am going to show you, hold on, is known structures. I said, remember I said the first thing I'm going to say is if reliability is known and the structure is known. Structures are of three kinds. Known structures are three kinds in reliability. Series means what?
This happens and that happens.
This happens,
that.
This happens, this happens, series. Parallel is what?
It's got two paths that you can take.
Two different paths. I can either take this path or this path, yeah? All right. K out of N, that means in this process, 2 out of the 4 components must be working. So I have those three. I have it in series. I can take this path or this path or this. Or I have 2 out of the 4 things must be working. Now, a series is like this. What did we teach you in Lean? That you must design everything like an assembly line or a cell. What is a cell? Series, 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 series. Watch this now. Did we lie to you? Yes, we did. Because from one perspective, Lean says that's what you must do. Then you go do it, and the next thing they do is they fire you. Why? Because that system, yeah, it's great when it runs, but it doesn't run. Okay? Why? Let me show you. In a series, the only time that I can work, remember this? This, and everything in between. When do you think a series works? Only here. That means if I have my status vector was his, or this, 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 none of those times would my system work. That's what a series means. So, do you think that when we said design a cell, what did we try to do? We set you up to be fired. Because you would do it, but if you did not consider reliability,
then they would say, oh my God, are you an idiot? Did you design this? And you said, yes. Parallel. What does parallel mean? That I can take either this or this. Watch this. Not this and this and this and this. I can take this or this. Now, when I do this right here, when do you think the system would work? Will it work here?
Yep.
We know the system is not going to work here. What about all of this in between?
Yes, possibly.
The answer is yes. If I now make it parallel, I have the possibility of what? Making all of this work, that if this fails and this fails and this fails and this fails, but not all of the stuff fail, I still have the possibility to make it. What does Lean say to you about parallel?
Buffers.
Those are buffers and they are wastes. I'm not understanding. I'm now very confused. In what class you're supposed to take a thing from this perspective and instead of parallel, make it series? In the other class, it says series is not so good. Take it back and make it parallel. All right. Now, I'm going to show you one more. Do you see the status vectors? Okay. And therefore, now, I'm going to come back and I'm going to show you. And there are two different types of redundancy. This parallel is called redundancy, and it's either active redundancy or standby. Standby is what? Like a generator. Electricity fails, you got a generator. Active is what? I got two processes running. You can run it through A or B. And I'm sure, now watch this, I have never been to your production areas.
What happens if you come up with all of them having no good? In other words, there's no.
Can I tell you that I'll bet you $10,000 that you have active redundancy throughout your system? Why am I saying that?
So that's probably the most important thing to remember.
I captured from what you have told me about your production is not very reliable. And therefore, to make sure that you meet the customer expectations, you have added redundancy after redundancy after redundancy in your process. And now the product costs not $100, the product costs $6,522. You're supposed to say something.
You're exactly right.
No, that is not what you want to hear. You want to say, no, that's not true. Because you see, these are laws that cannot be violated. Right? And what I want to show you one more. K out of N systems. How many of these do you think, will this work? Yes. Will this work? No. Let's say 2 out of 4. 2 out of 4. So would this work?
Yes.
Would this work?
Yes.
Sorry. Would this work?
Yes.
Would this work? Oh my God. So all of a sudden, when I have parallel, my reliability goes up. When I have N out of K, my reliability comes down a little bit. And when I become series, my reliability goes down much, much more. Yeah. I want to show you something. Your process of thinking is not if I can multiply this number by this number. That's not what we're interested in, because that's easy. When I give you the structure and I give you the reliability numbers, the rest of it is easy calculations. What I'm looking at is, when I have a system that is not reliable, how do I make it reliable? What are my options? I must have those options before you give me the math. These options are what? Simplifying the complexity of the system. Why? If I have 10 things in series, what is my reliability? This times, which makes the number low. What if I, instead of nine, I had two? By simplifying the process, my reliability goes up. First time that I see lean and reliability linked. Lean says, reduce the processes and simplify them. And reliability says, even if you don't change the reliability of a component, that by simplifying it, your reliability of your system goes up.
Is that the same thing as batch and variation?
Say that again.
Batch and the variation.
That is correct. All right. Two, redesign the structure. What are the structures that you have available just in the last minute or two? Series, parallel, and another cave. How can I redesign this structure and I still be able to enhance my reliability? Three, determine which components of the system do you think, not the structure, not simplifying it, I can't simplify it, I can't change the structure, so I'm going to go in and select a couple of areas and enhance the reliability of an area. Do you see that? And how can I do that? Four, introduce redundancy throughout your system. Or five, a hybrid system. Where do you think you have focused? Which one do you think is the costliest? Not only in terms of cost, but in terms of what? Everything. Supporting resources that you have to have. So, I'm going to give you a system. Here's a system. It can represent two different things. This is a manufacturing process. Part comes in, we do this, then we can go, we can go send it this way. Watch this. We can send it this way, or I can send it this way. It comes together, and I bring this, or I bring this, and I take it out. Do you see that? That could be a manufacturing process. It could be an office process. It could also be a strategy that says, guys, first we need to do this. We need to do 5S. We need to do this. 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 This could be a strategy. We want you at this moment to focus on the fact that this is a physical system. Could you please calculate the reliability of this system given these numbers? Okay, to the best of your ability. Go ahead and do that. Take 2 or 3 minutes.
They're all positive.
2 or 3 minutes to draw out the data.
All of our variables are some more likely than others. You know, some of these you have made a small decision problem. If you don't make a decision problem,
all right, let's take a look at how we want to think. Again, what is this? Known structure. Is that a known structure?
Okay.
Is the reliability given to you? So we may not have either the structure or the reliability. So at this moment, this is the easiest. If I was to think about how to do this, here's what I would do. See if that makes sense. I would combine these two together to make it into a single block. Then I would do this, this, and make it into all of this into a single block. I would take this, and this, make it into a single block. So I have a block here and a block here. These are parallel, aren't they? So I take the reliability of this system right here and this system, and I make it into one block. And then I take that block and multiply it by this block. Do you see that, what I did? What did I focus? Parallel? Then I have this parallel and this parallel, but I can't multiply these parallels, but I have to first get them into a single number. Single number, single number, single number, combine them. Single number, combine them. Now these are two parallels, very similar to this. I do the parallel, then what do? The series. So if I did this, watch this now. You see what I was proposing, right? This is C and D. So what is it, the calculation? I just simply want to show you how easy the calculations are, right? I take this reliability and say 1 minus whatever the reliability is, 1 minus. See that? I multiply this by 1 minus the reliability of this. So I have that number. 1 minus this times 1 minus this, I get that number. And then I take that number, that whole number, and subtract it, subtract that from 1. So what was the reliability of one of them? Was C was what? 0.7? 1 minus 0.7 times 1 minus 0.8. Okay, where did I get 0.7 and 0.8 from? Those. I multiply those. You see that? I multiply this, multiply those, and then I subtract it from 1. And the reliability is 0.94. That is easy. Fair enough? Question is, what did you learn from that? That when I have redundancy of, what is it, 0.7 and 0.8, that the overall system reliability goes, but I pay a price for it. The cost of redundancy. That's the first thing that I'm starting to learn. The second thing that I'm starting to learn is this. Now I'm going to take what? I said AB, and then what we knew was CD, right? CD was 0.94. So I multiplied A, which is 0.9, times B, which is 0.8, times C, which is 0.94. Do you see that? And the reliability goes to 0.67. So it's just multiplication of those things in series. So when I have reliabilities that are higher than 0.8, how's the reliability of the system 0.6?
They all impact each other.
Second thing I'm learning is if I put things in series and make them efficient, I reduce the reliability. Is that okay? Is everybody okay? All right. Now, I would take E, F, and G, remember? E, F, and G. And, oh my God, I got reliability of 0.27. Why? Because I got a 0.5 and a 0.6 in there. So what does that tell me? Every component that has a major impact in terms of reliability can impact that system. What is impacting that system is whatever I multiplied, let's say G was 0.9. 0.9 times 0.9 is 0.81. All of a sudden, I multiply that by 0.5. It cuts it into half. So what this is teaching me is any area that is discrepantly low will impact that system. Okay? And I want you to start thinking about it in terms of your processes. Is there any part of your processes? Are your processes in series or in parallel? Majority of them are series and parallel.
in series? Is there an area in this series that has particularly low reliability? Therefore, what do you think the reliability of the system is?
So then once you make all the A's zero, then you solve the regular.
Are we okay? Now, watch this. Then I'm combining parallel, right? I've got the top line and the bottom line, A, B, C, D, parallel to E, F, G, because I can run it through either process, right? I started with 0.6768 and 0.27. Watch this. When I put it in parallel, how did 0.67 and 0.27 result in 0.76, a higher number? And then I take all of that and multiply it by H, which tells me what?
Your overall reliability of the system.
Watch this. I want you to understand this. Understand this. In this structure, I could look at, what was it, 0.5 to be the weakest link? What in this organizational structure has the greatest impact on reliability of a system? Because I decomposed all of this into this number. Where's that number? Some number. Okay. Then all of this is equal to one number. I come over here and this becomes one number. You see the disproportionate impact of H. So then the question then becomes to you is, oh my God, should I focus on point H? No. Focus on F. F, which was what, 0.5? Which was the lowest reliability, was it? Or should I focus on something else? Or should I focus on improving H? If I was to strategize where to improve, where would I improve? But H is already at 0.9. But it has disproportionate impact. And based on the calculations, not everything is equal. It seems to have disproportionate impact. But then also, I have the impact of the reliability of each component. Doesn't that insight give you ideas on how to restructure the organization or the process, and what areas are critical to your reliability calculations?
All right.
What should we do?
All right. Have a piece of pizza and come back.
All right, get a piece of pizza and come back. How do you know it's pizza? Which one? Do you want me to go back?
Multiply 0.9 by 0.5 by 0.6.
Where are you? Which one are you looking at?
The bottom one. EFG.
EFG is very easy. You just take this, multiply by this, multiply by this.
0.27. Okay. I do get to it.
Okay. Series is just multiplication throughout.
Oh. Right. No. I thought you had 0.32 as that bottom leg. That was my bad. I'm good.
Reliability issue.
What's happened?
They didn't send enough.
Single point failure.
She wants to wait till everybody has enough to eat.
Go get something. This is.
Yeah.
She sent it back.
She sent the wolf.
No, she didn't.
There's two different stakeholders here.
Oh. Paradigm shift.
So, in the back room. So then that's one thing that's.
Come on, Mr. Engineer.
That's all going to be.
Oh, okay. It's
still heat breaking. She just won. I'm not going to let you go.
So, anytime that you have a parallel, minus the one minus.
So, when you have a parallel,
it's a small part of that. We subtract the one.
Those two one minus. Because your reliability is 100% minus.
Just look at it.
It's just like
that's exactly what I thought. Christmas already. This is just like if you've ever done circuits before, this is the exact same.
Yeah, it's just resistance.
Yep.
Is this ball down? Is this ball down?
How do you get like
their
point nine?
For what?
Yeah, but how?
What is it?
It's my problem.
Once I get it, I forget it.
Yeah.
But I get it.
I just don't remember why I get it. You know what I mean?
Right, right.
It's like
once it's in there,
I kind of
help
out. Yeah, we have
time.
Yeah, change the structure. Let's do it.
Once my brain collects why it does something, it throws that away.
Yeah, because you don't
and it just
it
remembers to do this.
Yeah.
So I tried and I worked it through it. I showed her a few things because my landlord was my neighbor, her granddaughter, and I was trying to help her through it. I was like, you know, I'm gonna teach you so many bad habits,
and you're not ready for it.
Oh, I love zebra.
Yeah, I like this one.
The fancy zebras, the 901s. I like these. But I do order them at work. I order the 501s at work.
It's like, I like the.
They have an ultra fine. This is.
Yeah. So I like the.
I like bright and red kind of.
It really approaches it for me.
I don't like
the 0.5 or 2.
What things really have to come before that? You know, logical. It makes it logical.
Doing it! Yes! Thank you.
Sorry.